Oh, I've put up a number of videos in on Facebook today and yesterday morning and evening and the night before. And it's about mind control murders. And I had contacted the North Charleston, South Carolina, because that's one of them. They're done in patterns. I'm showing Larry Flint because he was shot in Lawrenceville. His attorney killed, and he did an editorial. I was flown out to his home in 83 when a doctor I wrote about in Mind Control book, his plane went down, the KAL-007, August the 31st of 83, in the ocean, and all aboard died. So I'm not going to get into telling any more of that. I have an immune disorder. And the way that I've been made to move from place to place since 86, well, before then, but 86, is my immune system attacks itself if I get around toxic fumes. And when it's in where you live or a small environment and you're made or forced is really it, to inhale it, it can cause a lot of damages. And I even listened to Coast last night, and they had an environmental man on there that was telling about it, not just mold and mildew, but I'm talking about other toxic, very toxic, used in construction work or caulking and sealing and all that. And I've really been forced to inhale it. And over the years, my health has deteriorated to where now the inflammation has just gotten to my lungs, kidneys, legs are awful. But what I want to say was, in all of this, I've just told the truth about it. I told about my kidnapping. I was brought here in 41 to Moulton, Alabama, and this is me. 2 years later in 43, and given the name of twin, Peggy Ann Dempsey, I married Childers. Both twins were killed by their mother, Lina. Now, I don't know, I was brought to the Cortland Air Base, it's my understanding. I'm not sure how I got there, but it had just opened up during that time, so I'm assuming that I was flown in there, so it's who I am and where I was kidnapped from and who helped do it to me. I didn't find out about that until 83. So I've been forced to move when things would get so bad that I couldn't take it anymore, the fumes and toxic. And the odd thing is that people around me all knew it was done in plain sight. And what the law enforcement would do is get somebody something on somebody's kid or on them, or you can think of many ways they can do it, and in return they would do a favor for the police to drop charges or lessen them, etc. So I'm going to tell you how it played out today. Last week I had to move, and I'm not going to say who the state senator he used to be that owns the place. I stayed there, and I didn't spend money on anything. That's the way I've done. I don't have very much money, so hold on to it. I'm going to say this. I just couldn't take it anymore. I was forced. It doesn't do any good to say anything. I was forced to leave that night. It was a week ago on the 7th, although I had paid through that night till the next morning. It's odd how people, when they think they can get away with a crime, they do. So I left and came to where I'm at now, and it's a lot more expensive. I just paid for a week, but I called and was going to pay for one more week because it's raining. I can't camp. I've always resorted to that before, and suddenly I've got some other things going on here that maintenance should have come up, or maybe not, and done something about. The water, by the way, I was told was cut off all day yesterday. The only place I heard about it was in my room. But I don't know. Maybe it was out at all there, the motels, and I don't know. But anyway, they came up here, black man, tall. And I knew that blacks must own this or have been here because when I came in, the night I came in, I was booked in by a black young black man, and then I saw the next day a black older man and two guys that were cleaning up were black, and this used to be a white. And I've been writing about the NAACP covering up murders and stuff that were mind control, as well as the media. So they're jumping down the police and using them. I'm not saying they didn't do wrong, and what's been done to me, I'm sure it was. But if you're going to tell the truth, tell the truth, and that's all I've done. So today, as sick as I am today from the fumes and stuff that were put in here, I simply make a phone call down to ask if they're remodeling around me, and suddenly, out of the blue, I got the black man, great big tall, and the maintenance guy. Well, in essence, they tell me to leave, that I'm leaving. And then suddenly, I'm stunned. They tell me to put some stuff on the outside when I leave. I said, well, I'm not leaving until tomorrow. I was going to stay another week, and he reiterated what he said. And so I am standing there stunned again, even though this has been going on, and I can't get an attorney or the law to help. And there's a big, tall man that's suddenly moved in next door to me. Nobody's been there for a week. And there's he opens the door, and there's a white woman in there, and there's a black man in there. And it's kind of hard to take in at first, and he said something about, do you need something? And I said, well, I don't know, maybe I do. I probably need to ride out of here. But he told me, well, about that time, that was the second time I knocked at the door and told him that if he could give me a ride out of here tomorrow, because the cab's cost me so much and my money's dwindled because of what they're doing to me, moving around, taxis, losing food and clothes. And anyway, the woman was in there. She snapped at me and said, well, you just come back later. I've got a court date this afternoon, so you can wait, in other words. So he steps outside the tall man, and he offered to take me if I wanted to go camping, which it's going to rain. I can't do that, and I lost part of my gear. But anyway, I started thinking about it, and he said to me, he stepped outside, he said to me, they've tried to make you look like the crazy one, haven't they? And that's exactly what they've done. It is so hideous, the whole mess. It's unreal. So anyway, I won't go on with the rest of it, but I wish to God I did have a ticket out of here. I have not committed a crime, and I have been scared to death. You talk about terrorism. And if you just picked up this, I don't know what you would say. I was told by an FBI agent years ago, because I had a letter from the FBI back June 23rd of 79, and he pretended to yawn, and he said, you bore them with what you're telling them. It's only when they find out how it affects them that they care. And I want to tell you, this is a cold world when you tell the truth. So help you God doesn't mean a lot when they think they can get out of it.